This is a good recording, man.
Yeah, brother, like, dig it. Solid. Right on.
Good morning and welcome to the Earl Ingram Show. As always, you can join us at 844-967-2789. That's 844-967-2789. You can text us at that same number. Hey, good morning to you, Calvin. How you doing, man?
I'm doing pretty good. It's looking like we're going to get some thunderstorms
today. Oh, yeah, man. You're gonna need to build an ark. It's going to be raining for...
Oh, yeah, I know. We just got them... lawn mowed this week over the weekend, and it's gonna have to be mowed again after this rain's over.
We just got it mowed. Well, or you participated?
Sounds like a committee.
It is a committee. It's my brother and my dad and I, so yeah. We got a team.
Yeah, you must have a lot of acreage, huh?
No, not really. We live in a subdivision, so okay. It's not really that big.
Yeah.
Is this a real lawnmower, like a push lawnmower
Well, so our yard kind of has three sections. We have a front yard, and then we have a fenced-in part, and then we have a farther back part, and we have to push mow the front yard, and we have to push mow some parts in the fenced-in, and then we can ride the rest.
Yeah. That's a lot of grass to mow. Safe to say that.
I mean, if I got a bug up my butt, I could probably do the whole thing in 2 hours.
Don't do that.
No.
As a lay doctor, I'd recommend you not get the bug up your butt.
Especially if the bug is a cicada.
That's right. The cicadas. You know, I was once in...
Let me do this.
Yeah.
It's Monday. Oh, it's Tuesday. That means Tuesday is with my co-host, Sandy Williams. Good morning to you, Sandy. How you doing, man?
Good. I listened to your show yesterday about cicadas, okay? And I was once in Dallas flying through the airport, and they were having a cricket infestation. And I didn't know this. I get off the airplane in Dallas, and the window, the outside of the window of the airport is just covered with crickets. And crickets have gotten in through the entryway to the airplane, to the airplanes, and they're on the floor in the airport.
Wow.
And you walk along and crunching crickets. So I think the real horror of the cicadas is going to be stepping on them.
Yeah, I was walking. Talking a little bit about that. Can you imagine they're going to be blanketing, especially in those southern states?
Well, actually, it's all about these broods, okay? A brood, so there are these different types of cicadas. At least the type is measured by what year they breed in. And there's seven-year broods, and there's seven-year gaps between when they emerge. And right now there's an Illinois brood, and there's another one. I don't, and three broods are emerging at once, and particularly the northern Illinois region apparently is going to be deep in cicadas.
So northern Illinois means Wisconsin is going to get
Southern Wisconsin's going to have it too, and we'll have them, but apparently we aren't necessarily going to be touched by, I think it's called the Illinois brood, that is a particularly, you know, so they emerge. You know, they're living in sort of larva state underground, and they emerge every 7 years. It's creepy.
Well, it's creepy, but it's also, you know, very interesting.
Yeah.
That something like that can take place. And you know, I was talking a little bit about it. Can you imagine the impact they're going to have on people enjoying being outside?
This is really a segue, but my dad was a Mormon, and when the Mormons first went to Salt Lake, in fact, if you go to Salt Lake City, there's a seagull monument, and the reason there's a big seagull monument is the seagulls ate the locusts, because there was a locust emergence in the first year that they were all there in Salt Lake City in 1848 or 1849, and they were eating all the crops, the locusts, and then the seagulls came and ate them, and it was viewed as a miracle from God. The seagulls were sent by God to kill the locusts.
You know, we can. That's another.
It's biblical.
Yeah, that is, but that's another. It's seagulls, and you know when they're a communicable kind of people, a bird, right? I mean, there's so many of them. They really get along because there's so many of them together. They don't, you know, kind of get out on their own.
Not too much guerrilla warfare within the seagull population.
No, man. And so they stay together. Sandy, you see them You know, they just something about that bird. You know, more a lot of birds, they move away from their own.
Yeah.
And kind of start their own thing. But seagulls, man, they stay
flocked.
Yeah, flocked. That's the word I'm looking for. Yeah. They stay flocked. Let's go to John from Boaz. What's going on, John? How you doing this morning?
You have seagulls or cicadas there?
Well, we got rain right now, Sandy.
Ah, okay.
And I just wanted to comment and give you some real information about older people having trouble with getting around and their memory and all that. Well, we like music the most, and the next thing we like is birds. So I have two bird stories for you. Which one do you want?
First, hold on.
Tell us the best one.
Wait, John. What do you consider older people?
Well, careful. As soon as you're... Now, wait a minute, gentlemen. We've all been grown up, and we've been through high school, and we cut our teeth in the military or somewhere else. You know, maybe it could be a rock quarry. But
tell us.
We are not women either. Well, we're not children.
Tell us.
In the prime of our life.
Well, let's not go there. Tell us the best bird story.
Okay, this is up north, up in Wisconsin, Boom Bay Lake in Rhinelander. The paper mills used to have a big log run, and they'd float all the logs in the 2,000-acre lake, which has got muskies, backwaters to the Wisconsin River. Mm-hmm. We call it the Whiskey River up there. Well, Boom Lake, I took my canoe out. It was a fiberglass canoe, a 16-footer. And I went out to have a couple of beers because I was drinking back then. And I seen a loon to my left, way up over by the island. Then I seen another loon. They were calling back and forth. This one, other one, was near the beach where the kids can swim. That loon come over, and they both flew together, like within 10 feet or 15 feet of each other. And here they're like, I don't know, there's a quarter mile apart, and who God knows where they came from.
So for people who don't know, a loon is a bird that's very tall, right?
No, a loon looks like a duck, but has a more pointy beak, and they're diving birds.
Smaller birds.
So they dive into the water and have voracious fish appetites. Loons tend to kill the population of fish off on a lake.
John?
Well, we got plenty of abundance and an extra abundance because all the tourists it brings up there. The DNR does a good job of keeping them stocked.
There you go. Yeah,
they add okay. 1,000 fingerlings every season.
Hey, John, thank you for listening. Thank you for sharing, as always. Tell some other folk up in Boaz about us.
A loony story. Thank you. Looney Tunes.
You know, Sandy, interesting. But, you know, we are going to have some impact with cicadas. They are clearly going to be trouble. The only saving grace is they only last 6 weeks.
I don't know how long they last. They crawl out of their shells. It's kind of an eerie thing. Well, I've lived where I live now for 30 years, and I don't remember any infestation of cicadas during that period, so I don't know what this is going to be
like. Well, you know, it wasn't so long ago that they talked about infestations of cicadas. I don't know, 10 years ago, maybe. I remember this conversation. Well, 7 years ago that they were talking about this, and it never came to fruition, the magnitude. At least not in Milwaukee or Wisconsin.
Yeah. I'm getting my snowblower ready to clear. That'll be a mess, won't
it? Yeah. And then the only other aspect of it is, who benefits from, you know, cicadas?
Oh, there's
big birds are going to have a feast.
Yeah, obviously animals. There are animals that must feast on them. They must wait 7 years. They're counting the days down.
So Sherry says, hi, guys, from Horicon. Hey, good morning to you, Sherry, and thank you always for listening. But you know, Sandy, the fact that this is going to take place, and can you imagine baseball games and summer barbecues and those things being around? I say it's bad enough when you have a lot of flies, a lot of gnats. But cicadas.
I can't pick. Well, I can sort of picture it because I can remember that the cricket infestation that I experienced in Dallas. So, you know, and I think there are parts of the country that have infestations regularly with locusts and crickets.
So enough of that small talk. You and I are going to have a conversation today. Let me turn it over to you, and you can talk about the conversation we'll be having today.
Well, you know, I just briefly, at least, I thought it would be interesting. I was listening to the radio and reading the news, and in several different places, the protesters on the campuses, the protesters who are protesting on supporting the Palestinian position, were described as leftists. You know, the leftist demonstrators. And then this kind of brought me up short because I thought, well, now why are people who are protesting in support of the Palestinians leftists? Are the people on the campuses who are protesting in support of the Israelis, are they leftists too, or are they rightists? I mean, how do we come up with these definitions? And so I began to think about that in a broader basis. You know, what is the definition of someone who's a leftist? What is it that, what are the positions they espouse that are leftist, and what are the ones that are conservative? And it's confusing to me. I realize that there's not something that's altogether predictable about it, except that maybe leftists are the people who don't agree with you. I don't know.
All right, we're going to have that conversation. 844, when we return, 844-967-2789 is the number. It's Tuesday. That means Tuesdays with my co-host Sandy Williams and you.
I'm sitting on top of the world, just rolling along, just rolling along. I'm quitting the blues of the world, just singing a song, just singing a song. Just phone the parson, he parked, get ready to call. Just like Humpty Dumpty, I'm going to fall. I'm sitting on top of the world, just rolling along, just rolling along.
All right, welcome back to the Earl Ingram Show. As always, you can join us at 844-967-2789. It's Tuesday. That means Tuesday's with my co-host Sandy Williams. And Sandy, you got the music. Tell us a little bit about
Leon Redbone. Okay, Leon Redbone. I caught him on Tonight Show, I think, many, many years ago. He's a strange character. Always wore white, all white suits and a white Bermuda hat. And Panama hat and sang old songs, but very well. And I was listening to him actually yesterday, and I thought, well, where's this guy from? And he's from Canada, it turns out. Well, he's not. He's actually born. He's an Armenian, but he lived in Canada and moved to the United States. And I began to think about Canadian musicians and Canadian talent, because you know Saturday Night Live is filled with Canadian comedians, all of, going all the way back, all the, almost all the famous names you can think of were from Canada. And so today's music is imported from up north. Just like John from Boaz was talking about.
But all further, this music further is, up north.
This is all from that country north of the border.
So let's get into the meat and potatoes of our discussion. As always, you can join us at 844-967-2789. So, Sandy... I understand your premise, because I have always, every time I hear, you know, conservatives say those people are socialists, those people on the left, anti-American, anti-freedom, anti-family, anti-business, anti-Christian loving socialists, people on the left. And so what does that mean?
Well, yeah, how do you reach those conclusions about people? And what is it? How many positions would I have to take that line up with being a so-called liberal to be a liberal or to be a leftist? It's confusing to me because, in some respects, for instance, who is a leftist? A person who opposes aid to Israel? Or a person who opposes aid to the Ukraine, okay? They're both involved with wars. They're both involved with existential issues associated with their war. But which one is leftist and which one is rightist? Which one is conservative and which one is liberal? I don't think it's easy to paint that picture and to understand why. Who is for strong antitrust policy in the government? Who is it that wants to make sure that big corporations don't get too big, and is for antitrust policy? They're for a government that intersects with and limits the size of companies. Is that person a leftist who wants that, or are they a conservative who want that? And you can go right down the line on a whole bunch of policy issues and scratch your head and try and figure out. I mean, for instance, who is it favors Medicare, but doesn't like Obamacare? Is that person a leftist or a rightist? You know, where do they land? How do you draw the line? Because Medicare is certainly a socialized program being provided, a health insurance being provided by the federal government. But apparently, if you favor that for the elderly, but you would like to have that for other than the elderly, that makes you a leftist. You might not be a leftist if you only favor Medicare. How do we draw these lines? I feel like George Carlin a little bit, you know.
But Sandy, these labels are just that. And so people want to define people by these labels. For instance, Democrats in democratic socialism. So when did being a Democrat make you a socialist? Who defines that?
Well, how much socialism is socialism? Because obviously we have a bunch of government programs that are, by definition, socialist. Okay, at the turn of the last century, Milwaukee, and for 50 years, Milwaukee was run by what were called sewer socialists. But their version of socialism was parks, sewer systems, municipal water system. It was basically setting up the infrastructure for a city to be owned by the city. And it was deemed to be socialism at the time, but it became the general norm for cities all across the country as cities developed. So, you know, that is a form of, quote, socialism, to have parks that are owned by the city, to have a water system that's owned by the city, to have sewers that are run and operated by the cities. So are you a socialist if you favor that? Well, probably not. But are you a socialist if you favor Medicare for all? Are you a socialist if you favor Medicare, or are you simply become a socialist if you cross the line and say, I want Medicare for all, I don't want Medicare just for the elderly? I mean, where do we draw the line? Because socialism is something that exists in our country, as a process of government. All governments have socialized things. The army, the highways, the bridges, you know, the fundamental infrastructures, and schools.
So Democrats don't call Republicans socialists. Republicans call Democrats socialists. So I got to thinking about it, and I remember socialism as a young boy, and there was a defined, we knew what socialism was as it related.
Maybe we did. I mean, I think it was sort of during the Cold War that people got confused,
right,
about socialism and communism. And socialism and communism were sort of melted together in people's minds as all one thing, and socialism, at its extreme, is something like communism, where everything is owned by the government, right? But no one is espousing that. I don't understand any of the politicians currently out there who are espousing nationalizing private industry in this country.
So isms. Socialism, communism, and capitalism, you know, three different entities that all, if you dissect them, all have some good and some bad. And so you can't say to me that, you know, there's some nations that are socialist, that it's not beneficial to those nations. People can determine what those things are, right? But it shouldn't be defined by...
Well, I think the problem is that the word is pejorative, okay? It's become something pejorative, meaning it has a negative innuendo when it's used for people, a negative implication. And so the word socialist is meant to be a profanity.
All right, 844-967-2789. Love for you to join the conversation. It's Tuesday. That means Tuesdays with my co-host Sandy Williams and you. Welcome back to the Earl Ingram Show. As always, you can join us at 844-967-2789. You can text us at that same number. It's Tuesday. That means Tuesdays with my co-host, Sandy Williams. And Sandy, the music selection that you have made today.
Yeah, it's North of the Border. It's people that was Neil Young. Neil Young's another of the Canadians who came and brought us a lot of good music.
And so, and for people who may just be joining us, our conversation is about,
well, we're trying to pin down what it is in the world of news, we tend to talk about leftists, we tend to talk about rightists, people on the far right, conservatives, and I'm trying to figure out the labels, because they're beginning to confuse me, and I wonder whether the news media ought to think more carefully about it before they use them, and maybe we all ought to think more carefully, because those labels tend to have are used for a reason, right? I mean, people who use the word leftist are using it because they think it's a negative. They think it's a pejorative term. It's an accusation, essentially. The same is true of socialist. The same is true of far right. I mean, when we talk about someone on the far right, we're talking about we're trying to define them as being out there, right, on the fringe. And all these notions that people are on the fringe, it just doesn't square with logic frequently.
So from the text line, Brendan says the Republican weaponization of words, socialism and communism, radical. Stephen says Biden hasn't overstepped when it comes to the free market, but I would like to see his administration get back to tougher trust-busting policies, because the way America is going with these corporations and dark money in politics and the military-industrial complex is not sustainable. Corporations say they were forced to raise prices, but their profits have been skyrocketing, hitting an all-time record high of $2.8 trillion in fourth quarter of 2023. Capitalism has gone off the rails with the Bella.
Yeah, I think, and I think that's a, you know, I was saying before the break that, you know, for instance, antitrust policy, the government intervening into the market to try and make sure that businesses don't get too big so that they can have market control, so they can set prices, is, if you favor that, are you a conservative or a liberal? Are you a leftist or a far right person? And I think the fact is that both sides should be favoring that. Certainly conservatives should favor antitrust policy that keeps the marketplace working, because the premise of conservatism is primarily open free markets, market mechanisms being in control of decision making. But markets don't work if there are, if there's monopoly power in the marketplace.
So this is an article from the New York Times from 2019, and it talks about, you know, the exact same thing. What is democratic socialism? Whose version are we talking about? Let me read one quick paragraph and we'll go to the phone lines. Democratic socialism has become a major force in American political life. Just look at Senator Bernie Sanders of Vermont and Elizabeth Warren. Democratic socialism has a definition. Political theory isn't exactly crowd pleaser on the campaign trail, but you need some of it to understand why democratic socialism means so many things to so many people. Leftist political theory encompasses a wide range of ideologies which can be divided roughly into three categories. Communism, democratic socialism, and
Well, you know, I think that very article falls into its own trap. It talks about leftists and leftist theories. And the fact is that some of these things are not really leftist. I mean, you know, the notion, for instance, of a government that's active in the area of antitrust policy isn't leftist. It's probably rightist. It's neutral. And I think what's happened is we've become so hidebound to try and label thought process, you know, different thinking as either conservative or liberal, as either leftist or rightist, as either socialist or capitalist, when in fact it's not that clear at all.
Let's go to the phone lines and Mike from Kenosha. Good morning to you, Mike. How you doing, sir?
Enjoying a beautiful morning. Thanks for taking my call, as always. What a great topic. I'm sure glad you guys brought it up. Labels. They mean different things to different people. In our nation, we're a nation of 340 million people. I sure hope we have the complete rainbow of ideologies and personalities and different ways of thinking. That's what makes a great nation. But there's no question, like one of your texts that you read a moment ago said that, these words are being weaponized. You know, liberals, the term liberal since Reagan has been ad hominem to many of the right wingers. And when's the last time you've heard the media talk about the radical right? You don't. But you hear leftists, you hear socialists, you hear communists, and all these other depictions all the time. Because we are in a divide and conquer era. We have very little journalism going on anymore. We're surrounded by influencers in a machine built to influence. I think this is a great topic. The first step in divide and conquer is to categorize people. And then the second step is to attack. And just like, the Lewis Powell memo clearly states, weaponize the system. and use the system to gain your own needs while doing this in clandestine, in dark operations. That's where we're at. And I think the first step that we need to do is declassify. Recognize that, you know, a great nation has 1,000 different ideologies and different viewpoints. And, you know, just like artificial intelligence is, you know, it's a better thing to have more. It's a better way forward. So
I'm
long-winded on this.
Well, so Mike, let me ask you, do you think that people on, you know, the conservative or Republican side or far right, whatever you want to call them, really understand the depth of what is being done to them when they buy into these things? And it's easy to say, well, you know, he's a socialist, he's a communist, you know, and those kinds of things. Do they really understand, you know, what's being done?
No. Thanks for asking that question. No, I don't. And I think the lack of critical thinking, whether that's from the social media and our cell phones, that's causing this abbreviation of our attention span. I don't think. I think most people deep in their heart are loving, caring, altruistic people. And I have faith that that's going to, by the way, get us through our toughest times. But I think they're used to being told what to think. They are just becoming a bobblehead, if you will. You know, that when you're around the environment and you're being told that we report, you decide, and this kind of thing. You know, you start believing.
Yeah, I think Mike, you've hit on. I think you've hit on something, because I do think a lot of people self-identify as conservative or self-identify as liberal, and then they need to seek instruction as to what it is they need to think to meet the test. It's sort of like becoming a Green Bay Packer. Okay, what does it take to be a Packer? Now, give me the playbook, and so I think that's what's happened. People have decided to self-identify as a liberal or conservative, and then the playbook becomes handed to them without a great deal of thought. And I would say that both sides, I mean, I think the conservative side has done a far more aggressive job of labeling and of trying to weaponize terms, because I think that they're much better at the whole public relations process maybe than the liberal side is. But I think both sides are fraught with this. So that, you know, the liberal side has gotten all caught up in itself in a variety of ways in the woke, in what the conservatives have decided to describe as woke. It's sort of like the liberals find themselves counterpunching, and so they end up not leading the fight. They're counterpunching against the punch. So there's an attack, and then there's a lot of counterpunching, and that has been certainly what's been going on in this whole sort of area of sexuality and sexual preference. There's been attack and then counterattack and counterpunch, and it's gotten way out of hand in terms of the amount of attention it gets compared to what it ought to be getting.
So, Sandy, I'd like to ask you, what are Democrats supposed to do when Republicans are the ones who have came up with these ideas and changed the definition of words?
Well, I'm not sure. I mean, it's a little bit, I think we all need to go to the shrink and talk about this, because, you know, in this caller has just used the term far right. You know, we've labeled the other side as well. We don't have as many labels. We might not be as effective at doing it, but we've lumped them together and labeled them. We've got the MAGA Republicans, that's a big group and a label. We've got right. We've got
MAGA Republicans, Sandy,
are self-identifying.
MAGA Republicans.
Yes, they're self-identifying.
Nobody's called them that. That's what they want to be called.
Yes, but I think that it is true that, you know, I was looking at this and the I suspect the major labels used to describe the left in a pejorative way are liberal, elite, socialist, far left. But that then leads to views of them being anti-American, anti-Christian, unpatriotic. I mean, all these things get lumped into it because once you can paint a group as being the others, okay, this is all about, it is about dividing and conquering. It's about creating an otherness about a group of people, which then allows you to ascribe to them all kinds of negative attributes, which might or might not be applicable to all or any of them, okay? I mean, you know, the left is certainly not anti-American. They might be wanting to change America. It turns out that I think the conservative right want to change America, too. They want to get rid of all the liberals.
Well, so
they want to get rid of liberal thinking.
Sandy,
that's changing America.
I will say to you that the change in America is going to happen. And from my perspective, those on the right don't want to see that change. And they're pushing back against it. And they're using all of these things to prevent what is inevitable.
Yes.
America is going through a transformation.
Well, I think that's almost always what happens. I would accuse the conservatives, many of them, of being what's called reactionary. And by reactionary, typically that term is used to mean people who want to turn the clock back, get it back to what it was, because they don't like where it's going, okay? And I think what is happening now is there's a freight train on the track, and it's America moving along towards its future. And there are people who are trying to put barricades up, trying to figure out what they can put on the tracks to slow that down, maybe stop it, okay? And it has a desperate quality to it, because when you're fighting against what seems inevitable, it's desperate.
So we've got a lot of texts responding to this. We'll read those as well as going to the phone lines on the other side. 844-967-2789 is the number. It's Tuesday. That means Tuesdays with my co-host Sandy Williams, and a fascinating discussion as always on the early.
Joni Mitchell.
Yeah.
But now they only block the sun. They rain and snow on everyone. So many things I would have done. But clouds got in my way. I've looked at clouds from both sides now. From up and down. And still somehow we
All right. Welcome back to a Tuesday edition of the Earl Ingram Show. It's Tuesday. That means Tuesdays with my co-host Sandy Williams. A great, great conversation. Our phone lines are open at 844-967-2789. Let me read a few more texts before we go back to the phone line. The real danger in the U.S. is the injection of religion into a political party. This is clearly seen. Where the Democratic Party looks more like America, the Republican Party reflects more the white population, and they're all too old. Let's see. Let's face it. The old guard GOP are long gone. Politicians now enter D.C. not to serve but to enrich themselves. Let's go to the phone lines. And CJ, hey, good morning to you, CJ. You say what?
Good morning, Earl and Sandy. Thank you so much for taking my call. What we're facing today, you know, you speak of journalism and reporting. There's a difference between pundits and journalists. Brett Baer, special reports, the number one for 20 years because he's a journalist. There's a difference between Rachel Maddow and Sean Hannity. They're pundits. If you want to watch the best news program where you get both sides of issues, it's Brett Baer Special Report on Fox. And you know, we're living your policies. I'm a conservative, always have been. And the way you define us is so wrong. What is the problem with make America great again? The phrase. The president can't say his opponent's supporters. He's the one that references mega Republicans. He's the great divider, and we see it every day. We're living the Democrat policies, and they're running away. Elderly black men, the black community, are leaving Democrats left and right. Well, and you see it?
Well, CJ, that's all interesting, but what we're talking about now is trying to dice out which policies it is that are conservative and which policies it is that are liberal and which policies it is that are far right or radical right and which policies it is that are leftist, because we've got to pierce through that before we can, you know, you've used these terms now. You've used them yourselves, but I think we have to at least self-identify what they mean. And then we also have to understand what they mean when we talk to one another, or otherwise they'd simply become pejoratives. You know, you frequently, when you call in, talk about liberals or elites, you know, you lump together. But I'm scratching my head trying to figure out in certain circumstances what's what. You know, what's far left, what's far right, what's conservative, what isn't. And it's a mix, you know. The capitalism version we have in the United States is not pure capitalism. There's plenty of socialist ideas that are built into our government with respect to Social Security, with respect to Medicare, with respect to roads, with respect to schools, with respect to all sorts of things. So we're not pure, you know, we're not pure on these issues, and it's a blend. And so my concern is we've got to start talking about the blend, and not simply knee-jerkedly talking about one another with labels.
Well, he clearly revealed that he's been watching Fox News, and that the greatest, you know, information is coming from, you know, Fox News.
Well, I do think this. I think I think we do have a shortage of journalists. I would agree with CJ on that. We don't have enough journalism. The industry of journalism has changed. There's not enough revenue to support investigatorial staff work in many places. Social media has replaced it. But what else has replaced it is very biased news sources. So we've got MSNBC on the one side. We've got Fox on the other. And I don't understand how you can pluck somebody out of Fox and suggest that they're the gospel. Because I think it's pretty hard to find the gospel on either side there.
Well, you can if you choose, and you have a right in this country to choose, you know, who and what you want to follow. And so, you know, there are people who have chosen to follow Fox News. There are people who've chosen to follow MSNBC. But I would maintain that what you should do is read and find out for yourself. On both sides of this.
Well, I think what's interesting is someone who will say, and I'm not quoting CJ now. I'm saying this is very standard. Someone will say, "I'm a conservative. I've always been a conservative." But there's no question that the definition of conservative today, in terms of the policies being implemented by the conservatives in the legislature, are far different than the conservative policies that were talked about by, for instance, Barry Goldwater, or after Barry Goldwater by Ronald Reagan. I mean, these policies have shifted. The label stays, but I do believe that the label, the people who adopt the label, are looking to someone else to tell them what the litmus test is for them to continue to be a conservative continue to be a liberal.
So let me ask you, because what's the point in having dictionaries and having words? And if you go to Rose's Thesaurus, and one of the highest levels of the interpretation of words, or if it's Webster's Dictionary, and you'll see the definition of words kind of already formulated, how is it possible then that people come in and change the definition of those words, which is what's taking place? And yet people are following the new definition of words that have been formulated to kind of separate and denigrate others.
I think the words, I think there has been a lack of precision for a bunch of words that relate to ideologies. You know, what is a Christian? That varies a lot based on what kind of Christian you are, which faith.
All right.
Same is true in politics.
844-967-2789. It's Tuesday. That means Tuesdays with my co-host and you, Sandy Williams, on the Earl Ingram Show.